Amen, amen, amen. All right. Okay, so today, you know, I just want to take this time, right, to share with you a very, very simple word, all right, that I asked God, you know, during this meeting, what do you want me to share with the people, all right? And before I move on, you know, I actually went around asking the cell group leaders, so and so, you know, what is that one definition? If I ask you this question, give me one definition, one liner or two liner of your revelation, or your definition of encounter, all right? And all of them, give me some very, very profound, you know, very little words, but very profound. And then, you know, some, you know, give me very long, but also very profound, you know? So we're going to hear from some of them, and we will start with the tertiary subject first. Woo! All right, okay, so the first person, right, that I asked, all right, and then he gave me a reply, all right, he's Wei Liang. All right, so Wei Liang actually said this. What is an encounter to him? He said, I would simply define it as a God moment. This one profound, simple and profound, okay, or not? Wow, very, very deep. Okay, Wei Liang, God moment. How many of you know what he is talking about? Right, it's a God moment. And then I went on, to ask the most handsome, and how many of you think you know who is the most handsome guy in this place? None other than the person who lead praise just now, right? So I asked him last night, so what is encounter to you? You know, what's the definition? Wow, you see? He said, having an encounter is having a one-to-one, face-to-face, personal experience with God. One that you know it is He talking to you. One that always leaves your heart more synced to His heartbeat. Wow! You know, hearing from a big man right now, we are here from the woman of God, all right? And Delphine, all right, the woman of faith, he says that, you know, she says, encounter is one, all right, that is unforgettable and change the whole course of your life forever. Wow, power, right? And then, you know, of course, you must hear from the subzone leader as well. That one also very profound, okay? Let's touch it. All right, Mr. Chi. All right, he says that, wow, what is an encounter? An all-consuming experience that leaves you completely convinced of the true nature of God. Wow, say. So these are, you know, from the four circle leaders, you know, in tertiary subzone. So let us hear from the youth, right? Youth. Amen, all right? Okay, and then the first person that I asked, right, Joycelyn. So what was Joycelyn's view? Wow, you see, there will be many encounters we have throughout your walk, but there will always be one at different stage to steer us closer to our destiny. How about Gwen? All right, Gwen, last year from Gwen, the younger cell group leader, right? Encounter to me is a movement of face-to-face communion between the real me and the real God. It's when His heart meets my heart with no pretense needed. All right, three more. Eswin, how about Eswin? All right, encounter, being heavily involved in something that causes a radical transformation or experiencing someone in an entirely fresh perspective that provides new insights. All right, how about Joshua, someone, the one who just shared that. I know, very famous, right? Okay, having an encounter with God is having a personal experience with Him and knowing the heart of God. Very, very simple, right? And then finally, all right, the last one, Sandy Wong. He says, whoa, she says, I would say, it's coming face to face with God. It's almost like coming out for a breath of fresh air while swimming underwater. Refreshing. Wow, what a very descriptive definition, am I right? Now, so, you know, after I review, all right, this 9 definition, right, and then I realized there's one thing in common, and that is encounters, they are essential and critical in our walk with God. Turn to your neighbor and say, amen. Amen. Okay, I want you guys to turn with me, right, to Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to 8, right? Okay, Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to 8, you know, you can look there at the screen. It says there, but what things were gained to me? These I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings. Alright, so over here, alright, is Paul talking in Philippians. So who is Paul? Alright, he's a scholarly religious leader with tremendous power and influence. But to Paul, alright, all his education, all his status, all his influence, all his wealth, he says, mean to him nothing as compared to having a daily encounter with God. He is like Mark Zuckerberg telling you that like, oh, this thing doesn't matter, right? He just wants to pursue God, you know? He's that powerful. So Paul's one motivation in life, it is to know God. And he says, knowing God is not just this word know, right? In Greek, it's ginosko. I'm sure all of us here, we would know, right? Ginosko, right, does not mean head knowledge, all right? It means knowledge through experience. Amen? So turn to me and say, we need experiences with God. Amen. And that is the reason why, all right, our Christian experience and our Christian walk with God shouldn't be dry, intellectual, and boring. God wants to give us life-changing, actual experiences with Him in the most, you know, intimate kind. Amen. You know, I'm very inspired by this pastor called Pastor Bill Johnson, right? If you guys don't know, he's the pastor of Bethel Church. He's one of the best pastors in the church world, right? And he had many, many encounters in his life, right? But there was one biggest life encounter that he actually written on his book, right? Okay, back then, he was already a pastor. It was in 1995. And then he was praying to God. He prayed to God for 8 months for an encounter. So he was a pastor, right, leading a great church, and then he prayed to God for more encounters for 8 months. Or 8 months, okay? So one day, all right, without him expecting much, you know, and then at 3 a.m., he was woken up by God. So he was woken up, and then after that, you know, he tried to wake up from his bed, right? But he realized that he couldn't move. He was totally temporarily, you know, disabled on the bed. He tried to move his limbs, his arms, his hands, to get down the bed, but he couldn't. All right, and then on his bed, God began to download the past 8 months, all right, all the prayers that he has made to God for this encounter. And God began to speak to him. And then at that night, right, at 3 a.m., he began to cry and weep in the presence of God. And God says, if you want a move, he says, you know, are you willing, you know, to give me everything and specifically including your dignity in exchange for all of me? And then he said in the book, he said that it was difficult, but he was willing. So he gave, and then from then on, he had a breakthrough and he experienced miracles after miracles in his ministry. Wow, amen. So, you know, as I was reading this, you know, testimony, I felt very inspired, and I also want an encounter like that with God. How many of you know what I'm talking about? And you want that real encounter, yeah? All right, so let's look back. And now to Paul, all right? There are three things, all right, in his testimony, in his encounter, right? His first encounter with God that we can learn, all right? And point number one, all right? We all got to learn and know that God wants to encounter us individually. God wants to encounter us individually, right? Okay, you look at Paul's story, right? Okay, in Acts chapter 9, verse 3 to 9, it says that as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? Then the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goats. So he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord said to him, arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. And the man who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one, but they led him by the hand and brought him to Damascus, and he was 3 days without sight and neither ate nor drank. Alright, so this was his first encounter with God. It was a very powerful, you know, encounter. And God loves Paul, just like how he loves all of us here. So back then, you know, there was a light that shone brighter than the sun that came all the way down from heaven. Alright, and Paul and the man who journeyed with him actually experienced that and fell flat on their faces to the ground because the glory was too big. So at the road of Damascus, Paul had an encounter with God. At the road of Damascus, it became the holy ground that Paul had a tangible and real experience with God. Amen? All right, so, you know, while there are other men, right, there were other men who were with him back then, all right, and then journey with him, right, and the light shone around him, so there were people around him. But only Paul spoke with God. This shows one thing. God wants to encounter us individually. Amen? All right, so how did God meet Moses? How did God meet Jacob? How did God meet Elijah? How did God meet the woman with the issue of blood? How did God actually meet the one who was blind and was healed, who met the lame and could walk again? How did God meet all the cell group leaders who gave all those definitions again? While you may be sitting with your friend beside you today, God still wants to touch you individually. Amen? So turn to neighbor and say, God wants to meet us face to face. Amen? Point number two, all right? Encounters are birthed out of genuine desire. Out of genuine desire. Now, let me sidetrack a little bit, all right? There are something that you need to know, right, about encounters. Encounters are ongoing, one. It's ongoing, right? It's not meant to be a momentary, you know, kind of experience. Meaning, right, an encounter is not like when you go to watch a movie, right, and then you buy the ticket, right, and then you enter the cinema, and then you watch 2 hours, and then you see the credits, you clap, and then you exit the cinema, right? It doesn't feel like that, all right? You know, an encounter is ongoing. It's not meant to be momentary. All right, you look at Acts chapter 9, verse 6 again. It says that, so he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what do you want me to do? What was his question? Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord say, arise and go into the city and you will be told what you must do. So, you know, you realize that God did not answer his question, but he gave a simple step of instruction to him, right? So sometimes God speaks to us one step at a time, right? Do not think that encounters with God are just for a moment. Encounters with God are always ongoing. It's continuous. It should push you further. Over here, Jesus just gave him an instruction. Why? Because he wants to keep that relationship and that conversation going. So in the same way, today God is going to give you an encounter, but it's not the end. It's the beginning of something new. It's a step of faith, you know, every step of the way. Amen? All right. So now, let us go back to Paul, right? So the point was, encounters are both out of genuine desire, right? So when Paul heard Jesus' response, it was a question, right? But without any hesitation, what happened? He arose, you know, without hesitation, arise to the city and go to Damascus and you will be told what to do. Immediately he arose and he wanted to go to the city. But little did he know, when he stood up, he almost tripped, he almost fumbled. Why? Because he couldn't see. He was blinded. He did not know how long would he be blinded for. He did not know whether it's going to be a temporary or a permanent problem. He did not know whether it will, you know, affect him for the rest of his life, his business, and in his life, right? But immediately he arose and he went into the city because why? He wants to go there and wait on God. The Bible says, right, he took that 3 days, right? You know, he did not drink, he did not eat, he did not drink. The Bible says he was praying. So can you imagine when Jesus says, arise and go to the city and you will be told what to do? He took it very seriously. Immediately he stood up, he put aside his physical weakness, he put aside the physical need, his blindness, he still went and he obeyed. He took God's word seriously. He was hungry for God to speak again. God gave him an encounter at the road of Damascus, but he did not want it to be end. He did it to be the end. Right? He wanted it to be continuous. He go there, he pursued, he, you know, was serious about the word of God. In the same way, you know, all of us here, you know, sometimes meeting with God leads us to put aside that physical need, the physical worry, the physical stuff, the world stuff, right, the things that you are going through. Put that aside. And when Paul met him, right, and then he was blinded for 3 days, after that 3 days, he was totally transformed by God. Amen? Illustration, you know, that I actually was very inspired was two, three weeks back, we actually had a camp prayer meeting, and Xing-Yi actually shared the testimony. So she shared something. Let me see Xing-Yi. Ah, yeah, Xing-Yi. Yeah, correct. Yeah, Xing-Yi. So Xing-Yi shared her testimony, and I was very, very touched by her testimony because she said she came to church for some time. And then she, you know, she came, but the work with God was very, very dry. So one day, you know, she said that every single time she looked at her friends on the left, on the right, they were here in the presence of God, but she herself is not touched by God. So she continued coming and coming and coming. But one day she reached a point of desperation. She said, God, I don't want to remain at where I am today. I want to encounter you. And out of that desire. When she went for camp YOLO, that was when God touched her so much that she had tears flowing in her eyes, and now she's on fire for God. Amen? So, you know, it takes hunger. It takes a desire for us to encounter God. Amen? So turn around and say, I got to desire God. Amen. At point number three, my last point, and that is encounters. You may not, you know, maybe some of you will not expect me to say that. Okay, point three, encounters demands obedience. Encounters demand obedience. Three things we need to learn, right? Number one, God wants to give us individual encounters, right? And then point two, encounters are birthed out of genuine desire. And number three, encounters demand obedience. Do you know, right? Many of us, we thought that the encounter with God, you know, was, you know, what the thing that changed Paul's life. Yeah, that was it. But there's something else that added on to it. You see, Acts chapter 9 was what happened to Paul at that point of time, right? I want you to fast forward now. Fast forward to Acts chapter 26 when he recounted his testimony of this encounter to King Agrippa. You look at what he said, okay? Acts chapter 26, it says over there, all right, let me just quickly read for you. And when we all had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice speaking to me. So he recounted what happened, right? So why are you persecuting me? So I said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. But rise and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness, both to the things which you have seen and of the things which I have yet revealed to you, that you may receive forgiveness of sin, that they may receive forgiveness of sin and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. So basically, that 3 days of blindness, God spoke to him about that purpose, right? And then it says that, therefore, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. What causes him to change, right, from a person who was, you know, totally persecutor of Christ to an apostle of Paul? Apostle Paul, let me tell you, it is obedience. You know, during that 3 days, he did not eat, he did not drink, but God spoke to him that purpose. God spoke to him his calling. And then he was praying, he was preparing after everything. You know, 3 days, I'm ready to take. And he said that what? You know, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. And I want you to look at the Message Bible version. It says there, so after the encounter, what could I do, King Agrippa? I couldn't just walk away from a vision like that. I became an obedient believer on the spot. I became an obedient believer on the spot. This was what transformed Paul. This was the key that transformed Paul. He was obedience. And out of obedience, he became the great apostle because he was willing to respond and obey. Can I have the musician? All right, Tingjia. Yeah. All right. So because he was willing to respond and obey and not walk away from that calling, not walk away from that purpose. Amen? All right. And Paul, back then, he did not know that God would use him so mightily. He simply obeyed. You know, today, right, you know, in closing, you know, I know it's not a very long sermon, but I want to share with you a recent, you know, revelation that God spoke to me. You know, how many of you here, you are working already? Working adults? Not just me, right, working adults. You know, when you go to work, what happens? You need to submit your resume, am I right? So what is on your resume? You first write your personal details, your age, your name, you know, where did you stay, and then etc. And then after the personal background, what happened? All right, subsequently, the next part will be about your qualification, am I right? So that qualification, you know, your secondary school, you get what kind of results, your poly, your uni, you write all your qualification. And then what's after next? Your achievement. Am I right? So right now, maybe some of you, you are prefect, you know, in school, you are a counselor, you are, you know, all the skills that you have, you go for competition and you want this, you want that, you write your achievement there. All right? What gives the resume an extra boost is what? Experience. Am I right? You know, people out there, you know, if you want to get better, experience is the thing that gives you an increase in your salary. All right? So we need to have experience, right? This is what some of the employers, you know, look at, right? So God began to speak to me, you know. And, okay, back then, okay, right? I want you to go back a bit. All right, so if, you know, your experience in an irrelevant, relevant field, right, is, you know, your employer will not be so concerned. But if you are experienced in a relevant field, all right? It will give you a big boost in your position, in what you do, and in your salary, your reward. And how many of you know that every experience takes hard work? You know, every experience not an experience if it's just 1 month, okay? Experience takes hard work. It takes hours of time of sewing. And then the more I'm able to sew, the more I'm familiar with the industry, the more I can perform. Am I right? Now, so God, you know, one day he spoke to me. He said that, Seow Shi, you know, you want to do great things for God. You want me for me to use you. You need to present your spiritual resume. And he began to speak to me. He said, you have, you know, qualifications in life, right? For example, you know, God has given us some talents and then we have to nurture it and use it wisely. Relational skills, all right? Communication skills, leadership qualities, Bible knowledge, ability to teach, ability to plan, ability to execute events, right? All this lies on the part that says qualification. And he began to say, but for me to use you, you need to have that part that says experience. And the more you are experienced in that relevance of the industry, in a sense, right, in the spiritual things, the more I can use you. And he began to guide me. And he began to ask me, so Seow Shi, you write down. Write down your experience. Write down the resume. So I began to write down, you know, some of the things that I remember ever since I worked with God. Some of the encounters, experience part. So at the age, you know, of 15, you know, that was when I received God, right? So at the age of 16 was when I had my first encounter with God. I felt goosebumps, you know, when I worship. I was crying out for the presence of God. That was when I felt, okay, you know, wow, that was the presence of God at the age of 16. At the age of 17, during worship, I had encounter. And that was the first time I had tears in my eyes, you know, and I couldn't explain why. It was an encounter. At the age of 17, right, I was like some of you, right, I was team leader. You know, and during camp, God encountered me and challenged me to be a cell group leader. And then at the age of 18, all right, I prayed. I remember I prayed in leaders meeting one time. And then that was when, that particular meeting, I remember, I prayed and I literally cried. You know, I prayed to after the cool. I don't know why, but it was an encounter, right, in leaders meeting. And after that, there was a breakthrough, you know, in my cell group. At the age of 18, God gave me my first song, right, a new song in my bedroom when I was worshiping him. It was an encounter. Till now, I still remember how to sing. You know, at the age of 19, I partnered with God. I had a sub-zone camp. And that was when God used me, you know, the first time God used me to lay hands on people. All right, and I experienced the power of God. At the age of 20, you know, my soul was recovered in SOT. That was when I experienced inner healing. I experienced inner healing, and I had a deeper revelation of what the love of a father is. All right, at the age of 20, when I was in SOT, that was when I had my first encounter with the Holy Spirit. It was a strong manifestation, and I remember, you know, it was like some meeting about the Holy Spirit, and then the pastor was preaching, and when I was at my seat, I began to feel heat all above, right here, all above, and I felt my ears were so hot that, oh, I almost couldn't take it, right? And I know that it was the Holy Spirit touching me at the age of 20. Sometimes I just can't explain why, but I just feel it, you get what I mean? There was an experience, tremendous heat during that session. At the age of 20, it was when I experienced God answering specific prayer. I think some of you remember, I mean, we prayed and believed for 100, and God gave 100 in that weekend. You know, it was an experience, and God said, you know, I will never give you too little, I will not give you more. Give you exactly what you ask. All right, and then at the age of 21, new visions start to come, new dreams start to come. So during this time when God spoke to me, he began to say, so Seow Shi, age like that, right? So at the age of 25, at where you are, what encounter do you want to experience? What is the new thing you want to write on this experience part? You ask and it will be given to you. And then I remember I was there. I said, God, today, and as I was preaching, you know, I'm preaching now, in this camp, I want to encounter the fire of revival again. I want to encounter fire again. And I know when we have an open heart, and then of course encounter, and then God speaks, but you know it comes with a price. It comes with obedience. Just like also you want experience, it comes with a price, right? In the same way, it says, for every single new line, it comes with a price. You see, and I told God, I want the encounter. I want more of that. I want more of that. Amen. So in the same way today, God is going to give you the encounter. God wants to meet us individually. You don't have to look at your left or your right. There were many people that were touched in meetings like that. God wants to meet us individually. All right? And God wants to meet us individually. All right? And it's birthed out of genuine desire. All right? And it demands obedience. Let us believe God to touch us today. Amen.